In this tutorial, we are going to cover some techniques that will allow us to produce professional-grade mobile game buttons. It is a follow-up to the button analysis video that was released a while ago on the channel. But anyway, here it is. We can approach the creation of interfaces in two ways. First of all, like any other drawing or painting. This is especially interesting if we want to give our UI a cartoon or a natural quality. This is a particularly popular approach on cartoony RPGs or mobile games. We can also follow a more methodical workflow based on clean shapes, measures, and layer effects. That one is more accessible to those among us who are working with the mouse. And I personally use a bit of both. The secret of good buttons is that they are treated by the artist like any other graphic element. You can forget formulas and other step-by-step Photoshop recipes that teach you how to obtain a very specific effect without thinking. Shapes and effects that are too uniform will not cut it for professional mobile game sets. The charm of a mobile game button will come from the artist's style, the imperfection of its silhouette. You can see that on most of the App Store's good titles. You can still use vector tools, obviously, to draw the base shape of a button, but most of the time, a circle or a perfect rounded rectangle will not work as well as a subtly refined silhouette. That is true most of the time, but not always. It all depends on the aesthetics of your game. Even squares or chamfered hexagons may work in a futuristic setting. Simple geometric shapes also work really well for an application with a flat visual design. I just invite you not to choose this approach because it's easy, but because it corresponds to your global art direction. Painting a button represents no specific technical challenge. That is why we are going to focus on layer effects here. On Photoshop, the effects are accessible when we double-click on a layer. They allow us to transform our graphic elements in many ways. A detailed presentation of those effects goes beyond the frame of this tutorial. Here, we are only going to talk about some techniques among the most useful ones to create UI elements in general. We can apply a set of effects at once on a given layer in Photoshop, which already offers a good range of possibilities. But using nested groups, we can stack, thus combine, multiple layers of effects. It is that way that they are going to reveal their true flexibility and strength. Here, we are going to talk about three of the handiest effects to embellish our buttons. Effect number one, a sharp drop shadow to add volume. Some Photoshop effects, like the drop shadow, have a spread slider. This option determines the starting point of a given effect's fade or blur. If we set this slider to 100%, we get an opaque and uniform result, a bit like a contour. Such a cast shadow, set with the normal blending mode, 100% opacity and spread, will create a sort of base for our button. This is an efficient way to give the illusion of elevation or thickness. This is also true for the inner shadow. Contrary to a simple stroke, the drop shadow and the inner shadow effects can be moved around freely on the canvas. You just have to click on the document and to drag the mouse cursor around. Just be sure to uncheck the Use Global Light option. Otherwise, you might affect other layers at the same time. Effect number two, gradient overlay. When we are working with layer effects, we face one issue. They have a tendency to produce a flat result. A gradient overlay offers a good way to solve that. The idea is to place a layer that contains a gradient above our button in the layer stack. We apply the overlay blending mode to it. With a clipping mask, we can ensure that our gradient only affects the button and not the rest of the document. Another option is to use a similar layer effect called gradient overlay. The overlay blending mode works as such. A 50% gray will not affect underlying layers. Any color that is closer to white will both increase the brightness and the contrast of colors below. Any color that is closer to black will also increase the contrast of the layers below it, but it will reduce their brightness. We have to pay attention to our gradients mask. By default, a gradient fill layer or effect is applied to the whole document unless it is bounded by a mask. If you don't want to apply a mask to layers above your button, you can convert this graphic element to a smart object. That way, it will be contained in a document that you can trim to fit its size. Effect number 3, contact shadow and soft shadow. If we watch any object resting against the wall or the floor, we can observe a shadow that is both short and dark around the contact surface of the two elements. Another cast shadow, both lighter and softer than the first one, extends beyond the contact shadow. In the real world, those two components are the result of a single partial absence of light. But to understand and reproduce them well on the computer, it is interesting for us to analyze them separately. On Photoshop, we can stack two drop shadow effects and an inner shadow to give our buttons more weight on the screen, as well as a sense of realism. We just have to create a drop shadow with low size and distance values on our first layer. Then, we put the layer into a group and we apply a new drop shadow effect to that group. This one is softer, cast further, and has a different color or a lower opacity. It is not the cleanest way to set up that double shadow, as the size of the second effect depends on the first one. But at least, it works. That's it for this video. It has been a little while, but here is finally the second part of the mobile button tutorial. There is a lot to say about effects as well as UI design. This is a pretty interesting discipline, often touted by game artists. Interfaces can teach us a lot about composition, as they are all about creating a visual hierarchy and convenient arrangement for your eyes. So we will definitely come back to it as time permits. That said, I want to thank you kindly for watching. Be creative, have fun, until next time.